production video, I have to go and just adjust one thing, and then we'll start very soon. Thank you.
short notice, Dr. Kuplinski fell ill through the COVID, so she asked me to replace her about 3 days ago. So here I am, and so I'll work with you. Thank you. Hung-Kuan teaching a class in, I think, for the Venezuelan, the young musicians run by Dudamel, and it was, I believe, the Beethoven Fifth or something. And then he mentioned the tonality, the importance of each tonality. And for the A flat major, it was an A flat major section, he said, that's the Grab tone art in German, which means the graveyard tonality, and graveyard key. And Dr. Onga said, oh no, no, that's, why graveyard? I said, no, no, that's not what he meant. It's not about the, you know, the depressive view. It is actually, in other words, it is spiritual. It is not of this world. It is of the spirit world. And that A flat is a tonality of the spirit. And so, and that's, of course, sounds pretty exotic. And I said, of course, nowadays it's hard to think that way. But you know, what causes it is because of the tuning system back then. Just so it had it that the B minor would have been the tonality of the devil. It would sound so terrible. And the B flat for Beethoven, that was the heroic, the light, the positive. And then the E flat is the heroic, for example. And the G major would be something quite happy and gay. And so, A flat, just as soon as you start, I say, oh wow, it's a, there we go, we have this A flat again. Now, what makes the late Beethoven, well, what are the particularities of the late Beethoven's music in general that makes it different than before? I mean, we sort of understand the beginning, the virtuosity involved. You know, if you think about it. If someone really plays that tempo, you know, imagine the scale that goes up is incredible, you know. And Beethoven was able to play it. He was a really, really brilliant virtuoso pianist. So this was something that we sometimes forget. And in the mid period, of course, there's a heroic doing something, right? Strong strength and the relentless nature. And in the late period, there's a few things that took place, and that is something that softened his, not his character, but widened his acceptance. He accepted more of the gentle, of the beauty, of the singing, of the longing, of the loving. And so what? How did he express that? There is a, his music became more complex at the same time, more contrapuntal. There's a lot more inner workings. And he also leaned towards a little more fugal and variation. And what do they share? Fugue, variations, they have generally a subject, and that is being repeated, reiterated, restated, by each time differently. And that is perhaps his stealthy way of telling us, that's your life. It's repeating itself, but each time differently. It's just there's a slight difference each time that it comes back. Anyways, so the complexity and this this contrapuntal nature, I think it's something that we have to kind of keep in mind. Yes, the melody is wonderful, but there's contrapuntal complexities. I always begin with this piece with the suspended note in the A flat major. That just one note will make it, the E flat there, it keeps what's above at peace, and it also you know, it's supported the upper notes, and it also keeps the lower note at peace, and so it's a very important note, and therefore He turned it into a pedal point. You could, I mean, if one would begin this piece by playing that, passes by us almost unnoticed, but it's going to come to this to rest. So even though it is very short, now, how short it is, it's actually up to you. You know, this is the funny part, that if I were a conductor, so So, and then the trio actually like that, right? And about it, he took a little time out. Yeah, let's just try the little beginning. Play a little bit, just like what I did. It's too much. It's too hard. Sense how the fingers feel while you're not so fast. You can't feel this, anything that fast. Certainly not for the first time. And so that you can feel the travel as you go up down. You see, this is habit, okay? When you're little, when you're very young, of course we all have very weak fingers, fifth fingers. So teacher says, play loud, play loud, play loud. And as a result, 10 years later, you're still playing loud, playing loud, playing loud. It's an undertone. We have this. Oh, a harmony must build from the bass tone. What happens when the bass is loud is restrict any possibility of any sort of a liberty up there. It's being controlled. If I have a loud bass, free the right hand by yes. it's hard to think what it is exactly, you know. Yes, but that it will be the, it's the official word. If it were legato, if you were staccato, that is in between, that is neither. It's a little too serious. Now again, if I have the strong left bass, it restricts anything I can do with it. I play very top note. You see, it's restricted again. You know, it's like a dictating it. It shouldn't. It should leave us. The trouble is that when you know it's good, we slowly form in our mind the sense, aesthetic sense. You know, we have choices to make. And gradually we imagine, oh, a little more of this, a little less of that, a little more like that, more like that. And then see if that matches. Sometimes by accident, like that probably was by accident. But then once, if it is by accident, how did I do that? And try to figure out, you know, take a little sample of what did I do? What did I do? And then you can remember that sound and how you did it. Okay. It takes some time, but that's what I call dedication. Okay, let's now. Yes. Now, I need anybody who has played a forehand, work on forehand, especially the secundo part, I would suggest that you pay attention. Because if I were the secundo, I would play this with left hand and this with right hand. It will be absolutely automatic, with no fail, that you will be bringing out this. That's the top note of the accompaniment. I'm not gonna play. It'll be very awkward, but right, it will be right away, so that the left hand will play now all in one hand. Exceptionally soft. While this note, turns the music, make it sounding a bit banal, you know, it's like a kind of elementary da 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 di da 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 di da ba ba. But it should really, the bass is supposed to give a little impetus, you know, like the Baroque musicians, you know, when they play the gamba or something. It's a life. And that's a, and so that the right hand then can soar. Thank you. lecture. No, wrong. That's not how he wrote. Wrong. Well, that would be stupid something, right? That's stupid. That quotation he used over and over. But anyways, but you know, there are some very, very nice things you did. Now we have, it's always two notes, so that complexity of Beethoven, that he will use an element that he embedded somewhere early in the piece, and he will interpret this, you know, use it over and over, and using that as the seed of the entire piece. You will find that everywhere. like someone is pulling my sleeve. I was going to go ahead. But not, you know, standing in front of you, not going ahead. It's just pulling it. You know, you have to turn around. Da-da-dee. The string. And in the Schubert C minor. These are things that, believe it or not, composers are very, very aware of. Well, I once played that in Boston, and our a relative of my wife, Yehudi Weiner, is a composer, a Pulitzer Prize composer. He said, "Oh," he told me, "Oh, that was a fascinating moment there that you found." I say, "Which one?" He says, "Well, somewhere in the beginning." And I say, "Well, what do you mean?" I say, you pulled a little trick there. I say, "Oh." So I, when we went home to his house, and then I said at the piano, "You mean this one?" He says, yeah, that's the one. And, you know, the reason I said it's so similar to this is because the voice leading, that it's dropped in the middle voice, it dropped down. And we're in the process of rising, and it's like stepping into a hole. And that's the same here too. It seemingly it should be rising, oops. And these are little things that you will find just fascinating and fantastic if you pay attention. All right? But you know, you heard a lot of wonderful qualities. I particularly liked that the way you played the rhythm. This is not easy. You know, very often it is very sloppy. And he played with such precision with that. And I was very happy to hear that. But the things that I mentioned, of course, it is a bit hard to accomplish at a young age because it takes time to really feel, number one, to feel the necessity to do such things. Okay, I mean, if you live with a Beethoven for 5 years, then you might not find so necessary. You'll be just happy that it comes across. But if you live for 50 years, then you will only be happy when you feel that all the little things that Beethoven planted, all the little Easter eggs that he planted, you can find them. You know, then we'll be fine. Okay, very good. Let's move on. very terrible response from people. But I'm saying it again, you know, I studied with Hans Leigraf when I was 14, 15, 16, sometime there. And I wanted to approach this piece. He didn't even let me speak. He just said, no, you're not qualified. And of course, you know, I was very young, was the youngest student in his class. And he has brilliant class. So I, of course, took it respectfully, saying, yes, I'm not qualified, okay. And he often said about it, you know, something like this etude. Said you're not qualified. And it was later on when I was playing the 24 etude, I realized what he was saying. In that etude, we have one voice go doing that, and then we have polyphonic ability, the ability to play things polyphonically, and that polyphonically is not just say, oh, you hear this voice, you hear that voice. It's actually, do you know how to play? Do you, do you, do you, do you. Like a very good violist. And then there's the what you would call in the modern times the rhythm section. And then you have the bass, boom, 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 boom. If you can do this kind of chamber music, you know, little chamber orchestra, you can get together. And then you'll sing. Then you qualify. So, you know, I often look back and I thank him that he prevented me from learning this the wrong way. So, the multiplicity, we listen to the polyphony of music, you know, by the way, all the great composers were polyphony composers, and all contrapuntal composers. And I can't think of any exceptions, really. Because there are multiple aspects in music. So we have, thank you. then we have obviously, and then we deal with the melody. So we have then we concoct them together, but highly aware of each part what they're doing, what these parts are there for. What they're saying. Once you have that, then the music becomes self-independently alive. There's an inner life to it. It is not something that we force upon it. You know, that's the difference. Sometimes I hear the last year Chopin competition, I heard people play this many, many times. Each time I paid great attention to see how they devise, how did this person devise the beginning? Is there any kind of a design, any kind of order? There is the harmonic order, and then there's rhythmic order, and then there's the melodic order, and there's the gravity. Then there's the sound control at the end. Everything has to be brought on the one move to make it happen. And this is a challenging thing. So when my professor Hans Weigraf, he said, people are not qualified when they play this. And it's only later in my life when I realized, my God, the awareness that we have to first develop to really, so to say, accommodate all these aspects. You know, like you're a big mama chicken, you have all of those little chicks under your wings. You're holding them. That's an incredible task. Now, the next one. Accompaniment, we might call that. But is it really a compliment? He introduced it. The way I think of it, thank you. Sometimes, many often, it is a, well, you know, this is a pacabor. It's a boat song. People talk about that. That, you know, Chopin, once he was in France, he hardly left. He never went to Italy. So this boat song is a typical Venetian song, but he was never there. How can he write so well? And there's speculation. He must have gone to the exhibition of pictures someone painted it, and he imagined it. Well, let that be true. Just imagine that. You go to a museum, you see a, or make an exhibition, you see a picture. Then you start to imagine how that will turn into sound. What is a baccarat? It's a love song, of course. And it begins with two voices. The girl, so you see, it's a tough thing, because you have to be able to really immerse into that situation. But then once you are in there, the technical requirement is tantamount. The control of sound, the control of legato, the control of pace, of the smoothness, the line. The hearing, the horizontal hearing of voices, the multiple voices polyphony, the horizontal hearing of the harmonies, and how the, and then the hearing of the harmonic progression, that where the harmony wants to lead you. When you have all this, develop all these capabilities, then when you come to this piece, it makes sense. So, I don't know if I'm qualified to play it. I hope eventually I will be. But it's hard. It is a very hard piece. This is a late Chopin. And just like late anybody, it's always more challenging. Yeah. Let's try this, a few little spots. Let's try the first one. Keep it. You see that quite a lot. The students feel if they do something with it, their arms, with their wrist, with something to swing around a little bit, that it is then therefore musical. It has nothing to do with being musical, not at all, whatsoever. You see, when we, sometimes it has to be held, sometimes we think about, you know, what's between the notes, like the BC said, music exists between the notes. So this, this sequence, you know, it takes, of course, we have to play carefully too. It's not as easy as it sounds, because the right hand, the upper voice, actually rises up, always goes into a question. Is it? The lower voice says, yes, it is. They're of opposite expression, and we make them together. Pretty challenging. Now, let's try this. Would you be able to fish out where they are? Try it. It's hard to find. Just play the top. Okay, your arm movement was wrong. This ultimately has to go down. This is down and gradually coming up. Down, and then no more down and up, up and down, but now it's circular. two direction. Back and forth, this one goes down, and this one opposite. Your fifth finger in the sub left hand, it is very hard. Okay, it's a this is something often I keep reminding students. Usually it takes about a year and a half or 2 years to change. Okay, it's actually a deep-seated habit. But it's very, very hard to change at all. If So it's not easy. I'm not expecting that anybody will do it right away. But the fifth finger is already very skinny and small, and yet when we want to play the softest sound, we have to have the strongest finger. Because we not only want it to go down, we also have to keep it not going down. We have to dose it. You give the right dosage of how much to give, how much of attack to give. And that all requires strength. Soft playing is with great intent and not just a kind of, oh, you just relax. That's different. And that's also possible if the music does not need any musical tension. Let's go to the next set. Thank you. Now, let's try the right hand. The second voice should not be toneless. It is still an entity, but it is the ratio between the top voice and the second voice is probably 4-to-1. Four top voices, four times louder than the bass bottom. Consistency of the two voices were dynamically. It is a great technical challenge. Yeah. They need to be differentiated. However, once we play the second voice softer, we endanger it. We're endangering it. We might drop notes. And then it's worse than anything. And it's really, really hard, the first passage. And now on top of it, Chopin asks for a decrescendo. The second one we don't know. Just getting started, and so I'm not going to shy away. No. So let's try. The right hand. I'm sorry. Oi. No. Remember when I said 4-to-1? Four upper voices four times louder than the lower voice. Pressure of giving a note. And the next note is very close to that one. It's almost the same pressure. You must register it. Mm-hmm.
know.
You'll have to go through the entire section this way. Now, we talk about legato. We're crossing over note. Notes are crossing over. Crossing, you know, that's not the right word. It's overlapping. You're overlapping the notes. So, in order to get a good legato, and that sometimes depends also on the intervals. You know, the larger the intervals, the more you have to overlap. Also, small intervals sometimes we overlap it more carefully. But that means you're transporting the tension between the fingers from one finger to the next finger, and you have to dosage it in your hand. Be very aware of dosaging it so that you know it is a continuous transfer from this to that, to that, to that. And you know, if you just have two notes, you transfer once, that's not so difficult. But if you have to continuously transfer, that can be a real challenge, that you don't have time off to rest. And that challenges your hearing, that you constantly, you hear the duration of a note, and then it goes to the next note, and to the next note, to the next note. These few passages of the right hand, it goes by very quickly, especially in the performance. Before you know it, it's over. It's done its work. But to really play well, let's put it this way. You, when you work on this, you will gain a lot of experience and satisfaction through working on it. You know, that's where the joy comes from. It's that when you accomplish that, you can really sense the beauty of it. Yeah. Don't expect your audience to notice that. They won't. All right, very good. Let's move on. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
a few things. I'm very curious about this business. I play with arm. That's arm. There's imprecision, you know. It's basically playing with success. Students, young students, don't really practice Bach inventions anymore because in their view that is too elementary. It's not worthy of their time to work on. What we learn in the inventions is ability to sing. This is a very important thing. What does it mean to sing? The singers will tell you, you know, when you sing, you're using your own mouth. That's right in your face. I have a dear friend in Switzerland who is an alto. She used to tell me, when she knows, when she is singing, she knows when she's getting the note right. When between her ears, that is inside her brain, it starts to vibrate. Right. And then she knows that's the right tone. And I used to press her to tell me the experience, and she gets very excited in telling me. But you know, I can only sit there and imagine and dream and imagine what would happen. What would happen if I get the right tone? Anything, or the sky will fall down, or something will jump out of the piano, something will jump out of the piano, nothing. You know. How would I know that it's the right tone? But when we practice invention, when we sing, or say, sing, that you are, your entire being is with that voice. And so, so what does it boil down? It boils down to interval. The magic of interval, the art of interval. I have a very talented student, Chelsea Guo, who is an amphibian. She is a superb soprano, and she plays beautiful piano. And she does both, and sometimes two at the same time. And she has incredible coaches over the world. She will go and take lessons for singing. And so, the latest she was, she just visited a very famous teacher, and she says, you know, he was teaching me something that you have been teaching for a long time, the intervals. And often we think about, you know, talking about when we go up, which note is important? The lower note. You have energized the note so that it has enough energy to reach to the top. And she says, that's why she was making me practice over and over and over. And it was not enough, not enough, not enough. I said, I heard that. I learned that 40 years ago listening to Maria Callas singing. Listen to her sing. How she energizes the lower note when she goes up. It's incredible, incredible energy that intensifies so that her voice, when it goes up, it's like nobody else's. And we learn about that, and we learn that in the invention. If it's well taught, of course. So we learn to be at the moment of the note, but that's not enough. There's the beginning of the note, there's the duration of the note, and it's something happening with the note, and then it's almost ending, and then the transition of the note to the next. You know, if you can be with that the whole time, then your music is true. So, something like this. Thank you. This is a relatively long note. After the long note, we cannot have accent. So this got to be a little less than the C. And then you can you're free to do something. You can rise up, you can do a crescendo. And then you come back carefully and not dismissing it, not making it disappear. Yes, it will. It's a real quality issue. When you play it, when you, this is one of my brother-in-law, the famous conductor, he told me, he says, if you hear it, your audience hears it. If you don't notice it, your audience does not notice it. So when someone questions me, asks me, how come some people playing, you don't really remember anything. The other person plays, you hear everything. I say that's because the other person hears everything, and that person didn't hear anything. That's the difference. When you hear, we hear. If you don't hear, we don't hear. If you're not there, we're not there. If you're there, if you're present, we're present. So, which one is more important, the mind or the body? It's the awareness, the consciousness. Okay, now, there are a lot of little hairpins. I keep hearing, play that. hear him, dear, crazy Beethoven. You know, instead of a... It's a very demanding, and you wonder, what is he up to? What is he up to? What is the intent? What is the intention behind this dear? It's almost like trying to trick you while you're walking. And it's hard. And so dear da. That's, I miss quite a bit. And so this rhythm, da-dum, there's da-dum, and there's dear, oh, there's such fun joke. It was Otto Klemperer. He was rehearsing the Beethoven 7th symphony. There's da-dum, right there. And there, at one point, he stopped the orchestra and said, "Ladies and gentlemen, how come you cannot differentiate Marie from Therese? And so everybody started laughing. Yes, they're two different kinds. You know? And the first one is probably Therese. Da-da. And this Marie, calm down. Let's try from the beginning. Thank you. sampler, da da da, dee dee. Then we immediately perceive it. I'm making all this noise. Sorry about that. Getting on fire. You have the right hand? Hold on, the left, right hand too. That's right. No, don't play the da-da, it's D. No, the harmony that therefore created, how that harmony comes across. Yeah. Yes, the left hand was just ever too loud. Thank you. whole, I mean, I'm reading the music here. Here he put a piano. He requests that that is on the piano level. Play this from here in the piano. Okay, that's how loud you're going to arrive. Let's start from here now. There's something becoming more vehement, indeed. Something of that nature. If not, play softer. Yeah, but you're not paying attention to this. Kind of just sloppy. Does not make your music more musical. Okay, don't try to do that. Use your awareness. That's it. Now let's try. The first one was good, second one was no good. Try again. Can you just play this for me? Okay. And now. Good. Now one after the other. There we go. Okay, that's fine. Be with a long note. sometimes it's this the beat comes on. And not there, relax, total relaxation, right there. I learned a lot from that. You know that you are right there, that you are aware of this position, where it is, and you have no issue with that. You are completely at peace with where the hand is. And that taught me to listen to the music. Sometimes the note, right there, it is there. You are at peace with this note immediately. It can go on forever, undisturbed. And not, oh, it's no need. That's power. And, you know, that's the moment. In some history writing that Tai Chi boxing, the shadow boxing, was supposed to be, when it's in its original form, was the most powerful martial art known to man. That has the greatest strength and power. And you know, if you look at those people in the park doing that, you would laugh. How is that possible? They all look like they're dancing, they're relaxing, they're having a good time. That's because they lost that part, the actual meaning of each of the movements long lost. I learned a little bit from another master that it's actually the mind preceding the movement. So you actually imagine how the movement, the energy is flowing through your arms, through your fingers, through your legs, and it is forming the next movement. And then when you're strong, the thought is strong enough, at some point the body will follow, will do it accordingly. That's the true way of doing it. And I was thinking, you know, when I heard about that, I'll never get that. You know, I can sit there and think and think and think and think. Nothing moves. because my mind is not pure enough, because it's not focused to the point what, and I have no idea what I'm supposed to focus on. So it's hopeless. But with the music, when you play a note, you can envision the next note. And then when you're strong enough, you actually then play it. The finger would, well, of course we have to practice, but eventually the finger will go there and creating, fulfilling that dream of the sound, that image of sound. Then the music has its life. You see. Anyways, we should stop, we should move on. Okay. make sure that you have all the notes, because they all matter. All the voices matter. And as I said earlier, you know, polyphony and counterpoint. Polyphony is the art of the horizontal movement, and the counterpoint is the art of the vertical movement. And they go hand in hand. And we usually develop, when we practice Bach's fugue, usually we are more pointed to the polyphony development on this, learn to hear all those voices. You occasionally the teacher will tell you, here's a dominant, and then you have the resolve, and that's the vertical aspect. But usually we're not taught continuously listening to the vertical. But in Chopin, we actually have to listen to it continuously, because that is what, as I said earlier, that is actually what the drive is. Very often we say, oh, music must flow. But it's not flow artificially by our personal wish that it flows. It flows because the inherent need of the harmony. The harmony is moving on. That is what creates the musical flow. This is a lot of times misunderstood. Other ways are artificial. We can push in the audio. Sure. Easily done, but it never sounds organic. So, but you have a good feelings. You want to make it all. We have to make it more come true. I enjoy very much of your introduction. The first part is very difficult. Now, once you are here, what do we read? We read mezza voce, and then there is a decrescendo, a little hairpin. That's basically what it is. A little up, a little down. So, and then note a staccato, because it is this right jumps up and lands, and this jumps up, of course, the way we voice to the top. Yes, so in other words, when you play this, technically you do have to be rather assured. This goes down. Whenever you play this, it will result in a good balanced harmony. Good. There we go. Now let's try this. Just this. Use the pedal in such a way that it is a buoyancy. staccato. However, it's not, of course not, but upon the technique of pedal use. Pedal is a comprehensive use. Sometimes we use, in this case, we use for the little staccato in bass. And then so for the first note we use for the bass, and then we use for the right hand. And then bass. You see, that's the training of the pedal, is that it's not designed for only one particular voice or any one particular use or one particular kind of use. We have to know 1,000 different kind of ways that we use it. And then, according to which note we need to want, we apply that to it. So the foot, now the challenge of the pedal is something that's still a mystery for me, because, you know, from the head, where our brain resides, to this, that's about maybe 1 meter away, and for my brain to reach my foot, I'm 165, so that's at least about that. And now, there's a known speed for the neuron to travel, for the information to travel. The foot track is further away, but yet we are coordinating with hand, which is closer. How the heck is the brain doing that? You know, they're different. There's a time in difference in there. And how does the brain learn to coordinate so that it works together? A lot of times I once really observed what I was doing. The brain is actually approximating, is predicting when the note is coming. Because that goes further, so it has to happen first. And that I'm, you know, very, really dumbfounded by how intricate that working is when it really works well. Anyways, so that's the prominent upper sound, and then that would be the accompaniment. And then you imagine the long notes and staccato. This is one of the serious secrets. My dear friend Fu Cong, the Chinese pianist who passed away a year ago from COVID, very sad. When he demonstrated this was almost comical. He wanted to demonstrate that there's a staccato. He did this. So it says, there's a staccato. So you ask, why does Chopin want the staccato there? Because staccato has a different tone, you know. It's something.
something very bright. And then after that bright note, and then he softened. So the whole ball game, you know, instead of everybody trying to justify that the four E flats, you know, so boring. But Chopin actually had it in mind. He knows that's difficult. So he taught us what to do with that. And the one note shines. That's the secret of this voice, this line. So go to the long note, come out of the long note, so that it's not repetitive. Yeah, that's right. The most valued note we want to prepare. Like the word says, prepare means before. So it is going to be delayed. It's not talking straight. It's very circuitous. Pianist play. Don't be afraid of that. Because they think, oh, as long as I press something, as long as I wiggle something, I'm very musical. Musicality has nothing to do with it. It is actually by design and understand. It's like reading a book. I was brought up in Germany, learning my German, reading Bertolt Brecht. I've been mentioning this lately. Bertolt Brecht was a kind of a socialistic-minded writer. He wrote a lot of plays, and I learned German, my German, with reading plays. Because people talk. And along with plays came the instructions, you know. The person rushes onto the stage. The person backs off. But the person is afraid. And things like that, which are not in the words, which is in the little italics. And then in my mind, I had a picture that, oh, that person it's on the left side of the stage, okay, left side. And it's covering her face, and, okay. You know, I imagine all this, imagine the expression of this. So, do the words matter at the end? No, they don't. It's what comes across, how you say the words, how
not reciting the text. Just even if you recite like the greatest announcer, it's not going to do anything. How's your acting? How's your body movement? You know, that the complete picture matters. In this case, it is not the notes. It's what the total, sum total that comes across that expresses. You know? So therefore, we actually have to go to incredible details. Everything matters. Like you ask the son of the great directors, they're painting, yes. They're shooting, and then they go into the mixing room and say, oh, there was that. That's the scene. Out of 100, you know. And so, we imagine this thing, it must be so beautiful, so incredible, that Chopin wants to repeat it ad nauseum. You know, it just goes again, again, again. And so we have to understand why that is so. You were focusing on very much on the top line. And what happened is the lower voice disappeared. And as a result, there was no color differentiation. It's the harmony that creates the colors, you know, the different feeling tones, so to say. Different harmonics, different feeling tones. And you have to, in Chopin, the feeling tones is ever changing. It's unstable. You know, I don't know how to be, to live with him. Be a very moody and neurotic guy. I don't know. Maybe not, but maybe everything is internal. But there's a lot of changes over the sense. So positive. Now it's rethinking. Will that happen? My wife has been reading the new Alan Walker Chopin book, and she was, every now and then she will read from the book to me. They say, the disappointment, the despair, the not just the tragedy, but more the disappointment. And someone else wrote, that wasn't Chopin, it was about Schubert that I read yesterday, where it says, it's a memory. Is that of the memory of the past? No, it's the memory of the future. I'm thinking, wow, hold on, the Michael Fox checks. Forget. Michael J. Fox, memory of the future. But something to behold, you know, when we hear those kind of fancy things, behold it. And what does that mean? In our mind, that is perfectly true. The memory of what is to come. That for the first part. Now when you have nobody that I know of can speak, oh, I'm going to talk in this whatever like this, oh, you know, if you go to a Buddhist temple, you'll hear the monks talk like that, but nowhere else. You know, it's people breathe, they change. Let's try. The lower voice, it mumbles a little more. So I think you can speak. And then the right hand is the type, this is the future calling. Taking care of two parts. The left hand is busy. Doing all the arabesque. And don't think about tempo. Meaning usually it's expression. That you can loud. That's it. note is going to sound. We arrive at the note, fingers already touching the keys, and then play with the fingertip. Play with the finger. So it's not by, but with the fingertip. That's right. Let's try now. Okay, I still don't hear. How many notes are there? Five notes. Notes are there? Six notes. Okay, you must count them. No, I don't hear all the five. There we go. Yeah, okay. Seven notes. If Chopin didn't waste any notes, it's not wasting any notes, then we can safely say there are seven voices for this. Okay, that's incredible. But most of the time it goes to four, three or four voices. Chopin, six or seven. That's quite a common phrase. You know? It's quite commonplace that there's so many voices. Yeah. Okay, let's jump to one more thing and then we'll have to stop. So, I see that you play all four a lot. There, what is the serious consideration how to play this? The beginning of that. What's the challenge? The challenge is that how are we counting it? How are we feeling it? It is da 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 da, or it is tin 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 tin. Is it a Siciliano or is it a Beethoven? So, there are interchanges. Sometimes, other times, da. So, sometimes you play very well. Rather than you see, this is the fun part, you know. You have to know when it is changing from into and then gently change back or going the other. We have to know what you what we're doing, you know, how the rhythm goes. It's a fun thing to consider. Now, when you have this, just always play to the bottom of the keys. You can whistle. Once you pay a little attention, you see, oh, here's the large interval, oh, there's the same interval, but smaller now, smaller, smaller. Oh, it's a little more, this is a conclusive interval. Right? Reiteration, then Chopin's music becomes alive. Now let's try it. The next one I want to hear. Okay?
Thank you.
percentage, if you have done the finger exercise, you know exactly the, what fingering works and what don't work. Yeah. That I think you need to change. Okay, I think that's why I need to say what.